Senator Rosen, you are recognized for your questions.
Thank you, Chairman Peters. I appreciate you and all the other senators on the Rules Committee for bringing together this joint hearing. It's really important, and appreciate everyone for being here. You know, in October 2020, DHS warned that, and I quote, racially and ethnically motivated violent extremists, specifically white supremacist extremists, will remain the most persistent and lethal threat in the homeland, unquote. And that, quote again, violent actors might target events related to the post-election period, unquote. According to a former DHS Assistant Secretary for Counterterrorism and Threat Prevention, the Office of Intelligence and Analysis, or INA, was aware of the potential for violence on January 6th, and I quote again, but for reasons of fear, didn't want to formalize reports. We know Senator Merkley asked you this question already. But in fact, the day before the attacks, INA sent a national summary to law enforcement partners stating that there was nothing significant to report, nothing significant to report. And so if DHS assessed white supremacists to be the most lethal threat to Americans, and if INA was aware of domestic violent extremists mobilizing to cause violence on January 6th, then why didn't the department issue a formal intelligence warning that violence could occur? And I'm asking this of Ms. Smyslova.
Yes, yes, ma'am. First, we have heard of that report that we supposedly sent out that said nothing significant to report, and we cannot locate that. So I have no idea where that notion came from.
Can you follow up with us on that report, see if you can find it, or where we got that impression?
We've looked, ma'am, for a while. So we don't have a copy of that report. This wouldn't be an official report INA sent out. It is possible, ma'am, that what it came from was maybe a phone call or something else where we said we had nothing additional to report. We did view the work that we had done prior to January 6th as being sufficiently specific in warning of the possible threat. Some of the reports we did distribute, you just quoted from yourself. So it was our belief that those warnings were enough. Obviously, they were not. We are working very hard now to do two things. One, get better specificity and insight into this particular threat. And then secondly, understand better how our customers receive our products, read our products, who gets our products. It is unclear to us why they were not received and we were not better prepared for a possible attack.
Thank you. I'm going to ask a follow-up on that. Did INA share any intelligence products with national fusion centers relaying information about possible violence on January 6th? And is Capitol Police part of the D.C. Area Fusion Center?
Yes, we talked specifically to the Capitol Police in early December, made sure that they were in receipt of all of our products, and they received, again, the one we put out just a week before the attack that we co-authored with FBI, National Counterterrorism Center. We know that all of our products do go to the National Network of Fusion Centers, and we, in fact, participated in a phone call that was sponsored by the National Network of Fusion Centers the day before, on January 5th, where we also reiterated our concerns that we were in a heightened threat environment, that this particular adversary could mobilize quickly, and they most likely as small cells, lone offenders, they would most likely come armed, and they could were interested in attacking specifically government buildings and large gatherings.
Well, I appreciate that, but it seems like we weren't exactly ready. So moving forward, I know
you're correct.
Alluded that you're going to try to figure out where your product goes and who talks about it, but how are you going to specifically elevate INA's assessment that white supremacists are the homeland's most lethal threat so that quality, detailed, and informed intelligence actually reaches our communities, including our local law enforcement, ahead of possible attacks so that we can prevent any loss of life, certainly, or other kinds of damage?
Yes, ma'am. And the department is committed to doing that. Our secretary is very committed to coming up with a whole of DHS approach to better combat domestic terrorism. We are working across the department to understand how to better articulate the threat and deliver the threat and how to mitigate it with our state and local partners.
Thank you. I want to move on because the day before the insurrection, the FBI issued an internal warning that extremists plan to take part in violence on January 6th. Last week, I asked Metro PD about the intelligence failures leading up to the attack. Acting Chief of Police Conti told me that FBI emailed MPD an alert bulletin warning about potential violence at 7 p.m. the night before the attack. Mr. Conti told me, again, I'm going to quote here, I would certainly think that something as violent as an insurrection at the Capitol would warrant a phone call or something, unquote. But yesterday, FBI Director Wray shared that his information had been provided to local law enforcement multiple times and in multiple forms. So, Ms. Sanborn, it sounds like either Mr. Conti or Director Wray was mistaken. So can you corroborate Director Wray's statement? And if indeed the warning was only sent in writing, why didn't the FBI go a little bit further? Why did it not alert local law enforcement about the possible violent insurrection in a manner more consistent with the gravity of the threat on our country?
Yes, ma'am, I appreciate the question. I think I'll start with the information we received, just to correctly characterize what it was information off the internet unattributable to a specific person. That being said, the content and the suggestion of what may or may not happen was concerning enough that based on our prioritizing this as a collection priority for our 56 field offices, they quickly wrote that up and within the hour had that information to the Washington field office. They wrote it up in a document specifically for dissemination to state and local partners, but really they tried to belt and suspender that together. They wanted to make sure that we just didn't rely on the dissemination of a product, that we also followed up with an email. So it went out in an email to all task force officers on the Washington JTTF task force. And there's numerous of those from the National Capital Region that received that email. Still on top of that, they didn't want to rely on just the email and the written document. In one of the command post briefings that they were doing back then, every couple of hours, they specifically stood up and talked about this to try to have a common operating picture of what this information was. And then still to go a step further and not rely on just that and make sure that we broadened the visibility, not just to the National Capital Region, but that we opened that aperture to the whole country for our state and local partners, we posted that situation information report on what we call the LEAP portal, which is available to all state and local partners. And why that's significant is it gives them awareness, but it also gives them the opportunity to maybe even potentially add collection to what our piece that we got from the social media posting online.
Thank you. I know my time's expired, so I'll take this question offline, but you're encountering so many online threatening posts. We need to maybe change the definition of specific threats, raise them up. Thank you.
Very good thoughts, Senator Rosen.